This morning I want to talk to you about prayer a little bit. This is a nasty verse in 1 John 5 that really troubling. Has that troubled you? 1 John 5. You know, there's many verses on how to pray that are clear. For instance, we're to pray in His name as if Christ was praying it Himself. That's simple enough. We pray with thanksgiving. That's hard, but we know what He means. We pray keeping His commandments, and that's keeping His commandments before our eyes. It doesn't say obey. So glad that Mr. Davis came up with that. Mr. Gothard has been teaching that because in the one verse there, 1 John, or John, where is it? 1 John 3:22. To pray keeping His commandments. It doesn't say obeying. No, none of us obey all His commandments. We'd be perfect if we did, and if our prayer life and answers to prayer depended on it, we'd all be sunk. But it's keeping His commandments before our eyes, doing our dead level best to obey them and keep them. All right, then John 15:7, abiding in Christ, we're to abide in Christ. And Ephesians 6:18, praying in the Spirit, Spirit-filled praying. I had trouble with two of them. Matthew 21:22, pray whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing you shall receive. And that's a matter of faith. Can you believe some of the things that you want to pray for that God will actually do them? But then 1 John 5:14 and 15 really got to me. I thought, what do I do with this one? It's impossible for God to hear me unless I keep His, unless I pray according to His will. So here's, I'll read the verse to you, 1 John 5:14 and 15. And this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He heareth us. And sometimes you don't know what the will of God is. And if we know that He hears whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire of Him. This greatly troubled me. Okay, this was the situation. Well, I was in Detroit area. And there was the Canadian Revival Fellowship had the revivals. And the Sutera Twins, are you familiar with those? And been a revival. 80 of us that had been touched by the revivals met every one Saturday a month for the whole next couple of years. Prayer and fasting whole Saturday. So we got to know each other. I drove from Akron, Ohio, where we were on furlough at the time from the mission field, and that year I joined this. We were started one of these prayer meetings, and they were wonderful prayer meetings, just men. And a lady opened the door, and we wondered what, I couldn't believe this. Lady came in. Well, she stayed at the door. And she said, oh, please excuse me. She said it to the leader who was already up there in front of us. And she said, my brother, it's my brother. He's so sick. He's got cancer, but they did surgery hoping to take care of him. And he's so full of cancer, there's no hope. And she's crying and weeping. And she said, I knew you men were praying. Would you pray for my brother that God would heal him? They sewed him back up. They said there's nothing they can do. The medical, there's nothing they can do. It's just too far gone. And the leader said yes. And then she went. She excused herself and went. And then some of the men in the meeting knew this sick man. They were at the same church. So there was a discussion. What should we pray? And the leader said, well, what's your pleasure? What do we pray? Well, one man said, well, the lady gave us the request, pray that God will heal him. God can do that. God can raise a man from the dead. He can certainly heal this brother, even though they only gave him 4 days to live, whatever it was. And so one of them said, let's ask God to do a great big miracle. Yeah. And then another man stood up and said, no, I don't think we should pray that. Because I know what the brother wants. I went to see him the other day. He is looking forward to going to be with the Lord. He has told the pastor what to preach. The gospel is going to be preached at his funeral. He's picked the songs even. He's got a lot of unsaved friends and relatives and people he used to work with, neighbors, and he hopes that the gospel will preach, they will all come, because he was a popular man and a well-liked man. And he says he's praying himself that God will take him and that God will save a lot of people at his funeral. That's what he's praying. And he says, I think we ought to honor that. And then the other guy, well, it was more got involved in this thing. It was getting crazy. The other said, well, look, God can do a great big miracle. Let's ask God for a big miracle. And that could be a testimony to those people too. So here half of the, and it divided about halfway down the middle of 80 men and most of the sanguines and the optimists were going to pray that God do this great big miracle. I mean, this is it. And some of you can identify with that. And others of us that are more pessimists, melancholics, and so on, we're going to pray that God save a whole lot of people at her funeral. Now all the men had gone through revival. They were right with God. They sacrificed their Saturdays once a month to fast and pray. I mean, these weren't guys that were just, these were guys that had done business with God. But we were totally divided on this thing. And I thought, man, I wonder what's going to happen here, you know. And one guy says, well, look, let's ask for a miracle. Another guy came back and said, well, it's far more important that people are saved through his funeral than if this guy lives some more years. This guy was, he was in the early 60s, about 62 or something like that. And he says, instead of him living a bit longer, it would be far more important that these people get saved at his funeral. The spiritual is more important than physical. Now, what can you say to that? And there was quite some strong opinions as to what we're going to pray. Finally, the leader was exasperated, and he says, he didn't know what to do. You won't believe this. He says, okay, you guys, you men that want to pray that God will heal him, why don't you go in the adjacent room and pray that over there? And then the rest of you can stay here and pray whatever you want. And I thought, how wouldn't God be totally confused? You know, who's he going to listen to now? He's got a choice to make, right? He can do what. I mean, I thought, you know, and then we read that we should pray in one accord. And this certainly wouldn't be one accord, would it? This was, and I can just imagine, and I was doing some thinking, next month we're going to gather together again, okay? Now, either this guy is healed or this guy is dead, okay? Now, and then, you know, I thought if that other gang over there wins, then they would be looking our way and saying, hey, why don't you guys get some faith going? I mean, over here, right? Trust in God. I mean, they'll probably sit on that side of the aisle and we'll sit on the other side of the aisle. But if we win, then we'd say, hey, presumption guys, come on, get with it, you know, spiritual's more important than the physical. But it's going to mess up our unity in our group, isn't it? Either way, there's winners, there's going to be a winner and a loser in this thing, you know. And it could destroy our fellowship in a prayer group, and prayer shouldn't do that. But obviously, you see here from this verse, if we pray according to his will, he hears us. But we don't know what the will of God is. And you've all been in situations where you didn't know the will of God. Now, some of these prayer requests that I mentioned to you are very clear. But one about believing is difficult. If what you're asking for, believing, the faith thing. But then this one is absolutely impossible. I faced God with this. I said, God, what and how, if we don't know your will, how can we pray according to your will? So I struggled with this. We went, in this meeting, I stood up. And I said to the leader, I said, you know, I had a situation back on the mission field that, he says, why don't you come up here, Brother Koning? I said, no, I don't need to. I said, And it answers this question, because it can't be right for us to be praying against each other in two different places. Now, the Don Richardson I had talked about, the genius that's next door to me, he was wanting to cut a canal through the swamp so he could get his boat to the next river and evangelize that river. It was a dry spell, 9 months, no rain. It was dry. we were praying that God would send the rain. You know, people were moving away from us to trying to find water. We wouldn't be able to stay ourselves. So we were praying, my wife and I, and, oh, God, send us rain. You know what Richardson was praying? Oh, God, keep it dry so I can get my canal cut. You see? Now we're next door to each other. See? Now which missionary is he going to listen to? See, depends on what board you're with, I guess. I don't know. But he was, and we were both praying. But God, in his infinite wisdom, had it rain on my station, and we got great rain. All our barrels were filled and dry over there. He answered both, and we were only 15 minutes by air apart. But now here's a situation. What would God do? And I said, there was a situation on the mission field. And he said, Brother Koning, why don't you come up here and take this chair this meeting this morning? I said, you know, he wanted out. He didn't know what to do. I've had this over and over again. At headquarters, as I've been there for 8 years with Bill Gothard's ministry there, and many people send in prayer requests to headquarters. They really believe we're all saints up there, and we have direct lines to God, and Mr. Gothard has direct lines to God. And if you get that bunch praying up there, then that's going to do it. So we get all kinds of big requests. Some of these requests on sickness and stuff, you don't know what to do. What? And I usually, when Bill Gothard's not there, I lead the devotions at noon at the dinner. And I call on young men to pray. I probably have asked you to pray, Greg, the time when you were there. I don't know. But I'd ask different guys to pray. And they'd pray all around the thing. Here's this guy dying, you know. And they're asking to pray for healing. And they pray, oh, God, give the surgeons wisdom. Oh, God, give the doctor skill. Oh, God, help the nurses, help everyone. Oh, God, help his wife and family. Give them comfort and blessing. I mean, they're praying all, but they never say, they'll say, oh, God, be with him. But never ask and heal him. I would always face the young man. I say, now, why didn't you ask God to heal him? Because we don't know what God's going to do. Well, that's true. So we're going to quit asking specific requests because we don't know what God's going to do. You see? And that's not right. So I shared with him the story in the mission field. In the mission field, we came there. And, you know, everybody's lost. Everybody's mostly demon-possessed. I mean, they're a whole crowd controlled by Satan. Now, who you going to pray for, okay? Now, just take your choice. Now, I always go for the biggest fish in the biggest fish in the pond. You know what I mean? If I pray for the little fish. So here's a chief, family chief, outgoing guy, sanguine type guy, smiling, happy guy, became my friend, Awo. He was a true friend. I liked to be with him. He sat with me, told me the stories of the culture. I couldn't even understand them, but I taped it all. And later, years later, I listened to it and I learned what their belief system and all. But Awo was a great guy, and he was my friend about my own age. And I said to my wife, I says, let's pray for Awo. I mean, if he becomes a Christian, he'll be a natural leader. He's already a leader. I mean, he'll be a church leader. There's no doubt about it. And my wife says, well, what makes you pick him? I said, why pray for the little fish? Let's pray for the big one. She says, it'd be just like God to make that little crippled fella, Yasi, the pastor of the church. And I said, well, now how do women know this? Where did they get it? I marvel at this stuff. And she says, that's exactly what happened. Crippled little Yasi, the guy that I mean, little guy, crippled, fingers were a bit bent. I mean, bit of a hunchback. One eye wasn't too good. But anyway, my wife says, no, okay, if you want to pray for Awo, I'll join you. She's a good sport. So we prayed that God would save Awo. And I prayed especially hard to prove my wife wrong. Awo didn't make a move. No spiritual response in this guy at all. He just loved living. He was full of life. And, well, I took his picture. He didn't know what I was doing with my camera. I had this 127 old camera. And he wondered, they don't know what I'm doing. They found out when I brought slides back the next term. And I mean, they couldn't believe what I had on that on the slides. They showed them, I showed them stuff on the, they almost shot through my screen, man. They're going to kill this guy's spirit. Anyway, I made pictures, scores of pictures. I went to all the churches, Canada, States, on furlough. I handed out pictures. I wrote on the back, Awo, from the village of Abhoy. Pray for him, natural leader, that he might be saved. I wrote Awo and Abhoy so that they could pronounce it right, so God would, you know, be able to understand what they're talking about. And I would stand up in church, and I'd say, I got an urgent request. The prayer warriors, if you have a ministry of prayer. Now, all of us pray, but there's some people that have a ministry of prayer, that is their thing. It's not always the old ladies, as you might think. It's many times younger ones, sometimes men. And it's amazing, you find. And I asked, and every service to be maybe one or two, sometimes three, sometimes none. But most of the time, there was a few. And I'd pass out these pictures. I said, this is urgent, would you pray? I had hundreds of people praying that Awo would be saved. I had the best prayer warriors in two countries praying for Awo. If there was ever a chance, if there was ever an incident where people ganged up on God, this was about it. I mean, he couldn't say no. I mean, this was just, you know, firmly have the impression that the more prayer, the better it's going to get answered. Isn't that right? That's you know, the more people you got praying, the more chance you have. Is that true? Huh? I get both responses there. Okay, now, I made pictures, and I said, man, we're going to get this guy one. I mean, there's no doubt about it. And even I thought, is this right for me to do this? If my motives are wrong, which I didn't think they were, although I wanted to prove to my wife that, you know, it was more than that. I wanted a church in Abhoy. I wanted to, leadership is the most important, and a good leader. And I thought, but even if my motives are wrong, their motives aren't wrong. These dear people hear a missionary speak. They hear a request. They sincerely, and they put it on their prayer list, and that's what they're looking for, requests, these prayer warriors. And so certainly even if my motives were wrong, theirs weren't. I thought, so I kept on making more pictures and passing them out. I mean, this was really twisting. If anybody ever twisted God's arm, I did it. And, well, furlough was coming to a close, and I still had some pictures left. I got a letter from Nebraska. A lady got one of my pictures, apparently. I don't remember her. I wish I had kept a letter to so I could read it to you, but I didn't totally agree with it, so I threw it away. But C said, Mr. Koning, don't pass out any more pictures. She says, God has heard our prayer. What do you think? Had he heard it? Of course. Top prayer people in the place praying. He says, and then she said, I was praying the other day for your man Awo. And she says, I had this overwhelming, I was going to say feeling, but you're mostly Baptist. Overwhelming assurance, okay? Assurance is better for you guys, isn't it? Well, whatever fits you, okay? I had this overwhelming knowledge, whatever, okay? I don't want to get in trouble here. That it seems like God said, it's all done. It's okay. Leave it alone. I heard your prayer. So she says, I can't pray for him anymore. I thank the Lord for hearing our prayer. He's answered. He says, it's all done. She says, don't pass any more pictures out. I thought, whoa, where's she coming from? God didn't tell me to stop praying. Who is she anyway, you know? Besides that, I had a stack of nice pictures left, and I hate to waste. I'm Dutch, we don't waste anything. And I just, in case that lady isn't on the level, I mean, I might as well use what I got. And so, but as I passed out more pictures, by the way, do any of you know what this lady is all about? Have any of you been there that you were praying and it seems the Lord seemed to say, hey, it's all in the bag, it's okay. And you start thanking him for the answer, even though you don't even know the answer is. Do you know what she's talking about? I didn't think men. Anybody else knows? Was it a lady? Wow, that's great. Anybody else? You don't want to...
John's grandmother told me his salvation was assured 8 years before I saw it.
Sophie, okay, all right. But the Lord hadn't told me to quit praying, and he hadn't told me to quit... I mean, and I didn't know what this lady, what she was, okay? I don't remember the church. So I kept on passing out pictures. But as I passed out the pictures, there's something funny about this. I thought, if that lady's right, I shouldn't be. This is what convicted me. You're asking for the best prayer warriors in these churches. The time of the prayer warriors is very valuable because there's just so many people that do really praying. And if I tie up their valuable prayer time with a request that is already taken care of, then I'm guilty of wasting their time. They could be praying for other things. And that's what I thought about. And I thought, man, and I called for these dear prayer warriors, and they come up, and I said, this is a request. And I wasn't as enthusiastic anymore since a lady in Nebraska had told me not to pass out any more pictures. But then I'm not under her authority, so she can't tell me what to do. And so I passed them out anyway. Well, finally, furlough was at the end, and praise the Lord, this is all over. And I'm ready to go and lead Awo to Christ. And I go back to the jungle and hike into the village and meet Awo and sat down and I want to talk to you, Awo. And he was happy to see me, and I was happy to see him. And I said, Awo, you've got to become a Christian now. He says, I do. I said, yeah, you do. I mean, the lady in Nebraska told you. You're going to become a Christian now. He says, no. I said, yeah. I said, don't you want to become a Christian? He just... Nothing. Absolutely nothing. No spiritual conviction there at all. I tried again. I tried all my soul winning skills on him. Nothing would work. Finally, I thought, I've got to try harder. And I finally, he prayed a little sinner's prayer because he wanted to get rid of me because I was bugging him too much. But I didn't think he was saved. And I asked Haimo, you know, the guy told on everybody. I said, Haimo, is Awo a Christian? He laughs. He says, no way to on Awo. He likes you. He's a Christian around you. But when he gets out in the jungle, he's all over the place. He says, no way. I said, should I baptize Awo? He said, no way. He's a wild man. He's a evil man. Oh, man. Now, what would that have done to your prayer life? You had the best, I mean, didn't work. And you know, Satan gets in on our minds, well, God's going to do his thing anyway. He's going to do what he wants to do. And I mean, praying is just a good exercise to humble yourself before God, to keep you humble and keep you in line. But I mean, he's going to do his thing anyway. Satan comes out with that kind of lies to actually discourage you. And then, two, three months went by and had this plague come through. And my wife was sick at the time, so she couldn't take care of it. So it was my job, and people were getting sick and few died, and man, I'm trying to help them, and I don't know anything about medicine very much, and I called a doctor on a two-way radio. He's way over on the other side of the island. I said, Doc, this is what's happening. People are getting sick with these fevers, and and so on. And he says, well, try to diagnose it. Well, if you're not a medical person, you can't even tell whether a black man has a red rash or not. And you just don't know. You know, they, you can't talk to him well enough to ask him what's wrong. And he says, check this. So I walk all the way alongside the airstrip to the village and check this. And they said, Tuan, what do you, you know, I look down their mouth and look in their eyes and, you know, like, and they said, Tuan, what are you looking at? I said, I don't know, but this is what you're supposed to do when you try to diagnose sickness, see. But I didn't know what to look for anyway. Poor doctor, I went back and forth to radio, wore myself up. Finally, he got it. He says, it's meningitis. He says, I'll have medicine over there right away. He got the MAF plane, and about an hour later, plane lands with this medicine. He says, give this medicine to everybody that's sick, and most of them recovered, but I lost six people. One of them was a houseboy. He was a dear guy, that he was so faithful helping my wife in the house, washing and cleaning. And another one of the six was Awo, my man. He died meningitis. I had sat by him at noon, but he was a great big strapping guy. I thought, well, anybody can live through, shake this off. And so I talked to him a bit then. By about, just before dark, they came, said, Awo died. Oh, man, I couldn't believe it. It hit me like a bombshell. The guy we prayed for. And I went and saw him. He was dead. And I talked to his wife, Dadawa, and I said, how did Awo die? Did he die as a Christian? Did he smile? Did he talk about going to be with God? Or did he die in fear of the demons? Oh, Tuan, he screamed in fear. He says, he made me put on the armbands, that stuff, you know, the demonic stuff to appease the spirits. Paint his face and put in the armbands. And he says, he was so scared, he made deals with the devil. Surrendered his kids to the demons in order that they wouldn't go so hard on him. He was so scared. And I asked Yaba, his son, and he says, oh, my dad, he's gone to the fire. There's no doubt that he talked about seeing the flames, I mean, before he died. They were all shook up hearing this. Oh, yeah. I asked Hasselhai, his brother, he was there. Same thing. I asked Kitahu, the other son. He's there. I got a good report in this. Though he made deals with the devil on his children, that son, Yaba, his oldest son, is pastor of the Habar Church today. I mean, no, God's power can overcome any curse of Satan and any power of the devil. That's encouraging. Kedahu is his other son, is in the church. He's not a pastor, but he's in the church too. But anyway, I was so discouraged. I thought, oh, no, all these pictures, all this prayer. What's happened to the lady in Nebraska? It was way off base, wasn't she? I mean, he's going, who do I pray for now? Who are you going to pray for now? I mean, I almost think that the more prayer that Satan hears all this prayer and says, man, I'm going to wipe him out and he becomes a target. You wonder. But I didn't know what to do, and I started seeking God's face on this whole thing of prayer, and that's when I got these prayer promises that I got here. That's when I got stuck on 1 John 5, 13 and 14. I didn't know, we didn't know his will. No, none of us did know his will. Just like the guy there in Detroit area, we didn't know what God's going to do. And so I went on. I don't know who I prayed for now. 3 months about that. And then this story that I told you the other night. Remember the story I told you the other night about when they said everything, when they say everything you ever told me is true, sure to be dying, sitting around them. Remember that? And that's what happened after that. Now, by the guy that came and said, I'm going to be a Christian, we had never prayed for. I told you that. Here, everybody prayed their hearts out for Awo, and he's lost. There's no doubt about it. Nobody has ever prayed for Baida. My wife hadn't, and nobody, and I hadn't, and nobody sent his picture or anything, and he says, I want to be a Christian. Now, Surabhi, the guy that died in the jungle, nobody prayed for him. He was a little fish in the pond, but he obviously was a Christian, and he went to heaven. He showed us who was there, and there's no doubt about that. No, but none of us had ever prayed for Surabhi. Now, I ask you the question, how do you get people saved? What are the things we can do to get people one to Christ? And most answers I get is pray for them. And I say, no, that's not it. We are never in Scripture told to pray for people by name, for any one of your relatives or friends or neighbors. Who are we told to pray for in the Bible? For one another. Pray for one another, all the one another's of Scripture. Right? Pray for one another. We're constantly praying for our pastors, our friends. It's never told to pray for the unsaved. Check it out. No, don't believe. Don't take everything I tell you. Check it out. Okay? That's only right. Who are you supposed to preach to? All the preaching in the Bible was to the unsaved. Never supposed to preach at Christians. I know that's going to... What do we do? What do we do with Christians? We encourage one another. We exhort one another. We teach one another. We help one another, all the one another's. We're one. There's not one guy preaching to the rest. We're all in this thing together, helping each other and so on, teaching and growing. All right, so the Bible says, you check that out. What do? We preach at the Christians and we pray for the unsaved. Totally opposite to what the Bible teaches. That's why we're not getting anywhere. If we only read it, we'd find that out. Okay, now check that out. And so I'm praying for the unsaved. Now, why? Why is this? Because the unsaved, because God, when you pray for Awo, when we pray for Awo, oh Lord, please save him. God answers something like this. Oh, I gave my son to die for him. And Jesus could say, I gave my life's blood for Awo. There's nothing I'd want more for him to be saved and become one of my children. We've done all we could. We can't do any more. We gave our life's blood for him to be saved. We love him more than you guys down there do. But you've come to the wrong guy. It's his decision now. And we're not going to force it. God didn't force you to become a Christian. He will never force anyone to become a Christian. And though Jesus shed his blood for him and wants him saved, and he's not willing that any should perish, yet people all over the place are perishing because of their decision. It's not God's fault. So God can say, you're asking me to save him. Oh, I've done everything I could. I've done everything I could. Now it's your turn to be the proper witnesses and to warn him and so on. But it's his decision. And Awo made the wrong one. He heard the gospel. Surabhi, the guy that we never prayed for, made the right decision when he heard the gospel. Didn't he? He heard me preach. He accepted the Lord. I didn't even know it. He was a shy fellow and never walked forward in a church. I mean, that doesn't save you anyway. But he believed, and he's in heaven today. There's no doubt about it. And we didn't even pray for him. So now the question is, how do we get people? What can we do to get people saved? Well, we've talked about several things tonight, and we'll go on today, and I'll share some more of that with you. There's at least five things we can do, and prayer is not one of them. But isn't it amazing? But the other things are harder. And prayer is almost a cop-out. It's easier to pray and get it done, but I had the best people praying and didn't get it done. Anyway, Surabhi was saved out there in the jungle, and because Surabhi died the way he did, the church in Awo was started. Not through Awo, the way I prayed, but through Surabhi, who by his death got the church started. Now, who is Surabhi? Surabhi, that meek fella, was the younger brother of Awo, the one we prayed for. All right? Now, what do you think happened? God's, well, listen, there's, to explain 1 John 5, we got to go to Romans 8, 26. That's just before Romans 8, 28. You all know that all things work together for good to them that love God. Now, the two verses before that, let me read them to you and see. And these are the answer to 1 John 5, 13 and 14. And it comes in the Bible before it, so we should have that down before we get to 1 John. But we most of the time don't get it, and so we're stuck on 1 John, and we don't know what to do with it. We don't know God's will. All right, here it is. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we shall ask for, what we should pray for as we ought. Okay, that's very clear, isn't it? He helps, the Holy Spirit helps our infirmities. We don't know what to pray for as we ought. That's true. The Spirit itself should be himself, maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Notice, he does the groaning, we don't do the groaning. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit. That's God. He searcheth the hearts, knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints. How? According to the will of God. There you've got it. That phrase, according to the will of God, that we didn't know what to do with in 1 John 5, here it is. The Holy Spirit knows the will of God. Doesn't he? How does he know it? He's God. He's one and the same as God that sits on the throne. The Holy Spirit knows the will of God. He intercedes for us. Why? Because we know not how to pray as we ought. We don't know what to pray for. Our infirmities in the area of prayer. He helps our infirmities. He knows that we don't know. Holy Spirit does know the will of God. So he intercedes for us. How? According to the will of God. Not according to what we ask, according to the will of God. Because we might ask all wrong. Can you picture the scene? Now the Holy Spirit comes before God and he says, God the Father, I'm interceding in behalf of Otto Koning and all his prayer warriors. Ever so sincere. They don't know the will of your will. There's no way they can know it. But I'm interceding for them. They're asking for Awo. But you and I know something. We know that Awo will never repent. He's a man that's stubborn in his way. He will never turn to the Lord. So the Holy Spirit changes the name Awo. And whenever we say Awo, he says, sure to be. You see? Because the Holy Spirit is not going to go along with error. If you pray in error, and all of us have done it, haven't we? Have you? Let me remind you something. Have any of you ever a year later thanked God for not hearing your prayer the year before? Let me see your hands. Is that true? Many of you know exactly. You say, man, if he'd answered it, what a mess I'd be in today. Now it's for better. I was in high school. There was a young lady, one of the girls in my class. She was pretty. She was talented. She was everything a man would want for a wife. And I prayed, oh God, give me this girl to be my wife. I prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. It's terrible. I prayed. She wouldn't even look at me. 25 years later, class reunion, I saw her. Oh, I praise God. I praise God. I thank God. I praise God he didn't answer my prayer. Praise God. You know what the Holy Spirit did? He changed the name. Put Carol instead of her name. A Carol who would go to a jungle with me and face the snakes and the spiders and have children born there and raise the kids in that environment. A special woman. There's other pretty girls. I can't imagine that. Huh? God's done it. And he's done it for you, giving you exact opposite to what you prayed. And you know God changed something. And you know that he knows better and he knows the future and he's all right. So here, no doubt, the Holy Spirit interceded and said, God save Surabhi. Anyway, he taught me a big lesson. The Holy Spirit intercedes for us according to the will of God. The problem of 1 John 5, 13, 14 is answered in Romans 8, 26 and 27. The Holy Spirit does it. We So what can we do? Say, oh, God, this is our request. But if you want to do something greater that would glorify the name of Christ, that would bring more glory to the name of Christ or to God, do it. Isn't that what he's going to do? Learn to use the phrase, the maximum glory to your name. God, whatever is the maximum glory to your name, do it. Okay? Because that's what you're going to do anyway. Listen, there's a verse that says he'll do exceeding abundantly above all that you ask or think. Right? Never get less. You always get more. Above. I mean, that's a fantastic verse. The four adjectives. Exceeding abundantly above all. I mean, that's a fantastic verse. All that you ask or even can think, he'll do. He'll never give you less. I asked for $10,000 once to build a, we had to change our mission station, put a new airstrip, build a house. So I asked for $10,000. God didn't come to me and say, Otto, if you're really budget, can't you make $9,000 do? I could come up with $9,000 better than $10,000. No. He gave me $11,000. I should have asked for $20,000. I found out that God will do it above what I ask. And so, Surabhi was saved. And his death brought that whole group of people, 20 people whom I baptized. And that was the start of the Abhoy Church. And I'd asked for one man that he would start the church and become the leader of the church. We had a church. I mean, we might have had a leader if he'd given me my request, but we wouldn't have had a church yet. And then the leader of that church became Yasi, the crippled fellow. And my wife never said, I told you so. Good. But I sure was amazed. And so I was in this Detroit church. And we're faced with this man that's got 4 days to live. And I told him this story that I've told you. And I said, look, what we need to do, I asked him a question. Do all of you men here believe that God could heal this man totally? Of course, everybody said yes, even though the doctors say he's got 4 or 5 days to live, whatever. Yes, everybody believed that. I says, okay, then we're going to ask God to heal him. But some of them started, I said, no, just a minute. I'm not done yet. We're going to ask God to heal him, and then we're going to add this. God, if you want to do something greater that's more glorifying to your name, then that's what we want you to do. We want you to heal him or do something greater. You won't do anything less. Whatever is the maximum glory to your name, we don't know. But do it. That's what we ask. And one man says, you know, what I'm hearing is we're going to ask for a great big miracle or something bigger. I said, yes. That's exactly it, because it won't be less. Now you're getting into the exciting thing of prayer. You're going to ask for a miracle. So ask as big as you can. God says he'll do exceeding abundantly. If you ask this much, he'll top it. He'll do more. If you ask way that much, he can still top that. You ask as much as you can imagine, he can still top it. He can come up with something that it's so amazing. Anyway, and I said, why don't we pray that? We're either going to see a miracle or we're going to see something greater. And then they said, well, Mr. Koning, why don't you lead us in prayer? And so I led him prayer accordingly. And when we got done, though it was a mostly Baptist crowd, they were excited. I mean, they acted more like some other crowds. And they praised God. These guys, I never seen a bunch of Baptist men so excited. They said, we're going to see a miracle. And they're saying, we're going to go to that funeral and see what happens if he dies. Or others say, well, there probably won't even be a funeral to go there. We're going to watch what happens. I mean, this crowd is charged. This is going to be a great weekend coming up. You see, either he's going to be healed and there'd be. And I said, okay, let's handle every prayer request like this. God, we ask you for this. Do it or do something greater. Now your prayer meetings come alive. They come alive because this is faith now. God's going to hear us. And it isn't about God didn't hear us. He always hears you. But so we did that, and I went back to to the mission field that was on furlough, and it was a couple of weeks, and I went back and never heard what happened to the guy. That really, I mean, I'm out 5 years. I don't know what happened. Finally, I got back, another furlough, back in the Detroit area, and it was a friend of mine there, and I stayed with him while I preached in a certain church. And I said, Heber, whatever happened to this? Do you remember that meeting we had about 5 years ago when I was furloughed? We prayed for this man that's cancer. Remember? Oh, he says, oh, yeah. He says, oh, yeah. I said, what happened to him? He said, well, you know, the guy playing the piano? That was him. That was him. I said, so God healed him? I said, oh, it confounded all the doctors and everybody. They couldn't believe it. He's well. He's about 67 now. He's playing that piano. Okay? And then I started to think about it. You know, how foolish we are. This guy, God healed him, so he answered that prayer. But this guy's going to die. And God can heal, save all the friends and relatives and neighbors at his funeral. God can actually answer both prayers. And here we thought we had to divide up. And God could do one or the other. See, we put God in a box. God can only do this or that. No, God says, look, I can answer both of your prayers. You can both pray it, but all your hearts, totally opposite prayers, and I'll answer both of them. That's God. And that's why God is so much bigger than we are. And he knows so much better. And I thought, wow, he can get the best of both worlds. It's amazing. So that's what I experienced. What happened now to this lady in Nebraska who prayed for Alwa and said it's all? She had it. She had it right on. God says it's all done. Maybe Surabhi at that point was saved. Maybe that's the point when the Holy Spirit interceded. Maybe Surabhi was already saved before we ever prayed. Well, I don't know. He sat in my meetings. He heard the gospel time and time again. There was no use praying. It was already taken care of. The Holy Spirit had interceded and substituted Surabhi's name for Alwa. And it was all done. No use passing out any more pictures. She was right on, even though she didn't know what God had done neither. And it is so amazing. And yet I had real problems in the area of prayer because I said, how many times do we pray? You know, should we have prayed a whole year? I read in the Bible a verse in Matthew in the Sermon on the Mount, use not vain repetition as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard because of their much praying. Be not like unto them, for your heavenly Father knoweth what you have need of before you ask. Whew. And then on the other hand, I see verses in the Bible that says, persevere. Right? Persevere. And that's what we've been taught mostly, is to keep on praying. And we hear of George Mueller who prayed 52 years for a man to be saved, or something like that, am I right? And you, I mean, he prayed and the guy was saved after Mueller died. And you hear stuff like that. And you say, man. And I see two trends of prayer in the Bible. One that says, keep on, don't stop. Persevere. And the other one says, have faith, trust God, lay it down. Don't use the vain repetition. Don't be like the heathen. And that whole picture deal bothered me after a while. I thought, man, is this right to just keep on and keep on? And I've heard churches doing it. You might have heard too that have a whole weekend of prayer and they divide the whole weekend up in 15-minute to half-hour segments and everybody prays so that there's continuous prayer going on night and day. I heard one church doing this for a whole month. Can you believe that? They weren't going to give God a chance to even take a nap. I mean, they're going to keep him at him. I mean, he is just... And now what are they saying? We're going to show God that we're really sincere, how much we sincere, how we're willing to sacrifice. It's almost like doing penance. You know, as the Muslim that go up the stairs at Mecca until their knees bleed to show God how much sincere they are. As if, you know, many religions are that. They have to hurt and it's starving. And these Buddhist monks in the Far East who literally starve, sit on the street and so on. And as if that is going to touch the heart of God, so he'd have pity on us. I mean, there's not much faith in that, is there? And yet, I almost get that idea that you have to go that far. And so you have the two themes in prayer. All right, now after the break, we'll go on with this, and we'll discuss that. And we'll say, now, what is the Bible saying? Or is he saying both? But they seem to contradict each other. All right, what do we do this? So let's dismiss now, and we'll go on with this after the break in the next hour. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, how we need your mind, how we need to know what you're saying, how we need to know what you want us to do. We realize prayer is so very, very important. And yet, Father, so many of times we get so discouraged and we wonder what you're doing and whether you're hearing us. Help us this day to know for sure, once and for all, what you're saying, and may our prayer lives be revived and changed. Oh, Lord, help us in Jesus' name. Amen.